Praise the Lord. If you are expecting a miracle, I said, praise the Lord. From the top of your head to the tip of your toe, your brain, your mind, your body, every part of you, miracle tonight in Jesus' name. I am the healed of the Lord. I am the healed of the Lord. I'm healed. I'm delivered. I'm set free. I break every yoke. Tonight it will happen in your life. Father, we thank you tonight. We bless your name. You've been waiting for your people. And Lord, we pray that tonight, every life, every heart, every soul, everyone will be touched and they receive their miracles in Jesus' name. Power manifestation in every life. Authority, anointing, breaking yokes in every life tonight in Jesus' name. Do the impossible in every life. Turn every life around. That Lord, this day, your hand in our lives, your power in our lives will be unforgettable. Confirm it, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. God has blessed you. Sit down in the blessing of the Lord. Tonight, the Lord is revealing something to us. Many times when people come to crusades like this, they wait that the blessing of God, the miracle of the Lord, will come in their lives. But they do not know, after the crusade, what do I do? How do I pray? How do I take everything he has prepared for me? That's why tonight I'm bringing this message, the key of faith for a better, bigger, brighter life. I thought somebody would say amen. The key that he gives to us, the key that he's willing to give to every man, everyone, so that you'll have a better life, a bigger life, a brighter life. Look with me in Matthew chapter 16, reading from verse 15. And he says unto them, but whom say ye that I am? Whom say ye that I am? On that knowledge depends everything in your life. Christ asked, Jesus asked, our Redeemer Savior asked, whom say ye that I am? As you go about in life, in your heart, in your mind, in your thought, who do you say that he is? If you say, I know you are Savior, salvation will come. If you know from the depth of your heart that this is the healer, and you know that you know in your heart, your mind, in your soul, in your spirit, if somebody woke you up and he says, who do you say Jesus is? And you say, it's my healer. That's how healing comes. That's how healing is permanent. Whom do you say that I am, from your deep understanding, from your subconsciousness, who do you say that I am? If you say, I know that you are the deliverer, that there is no yoke and there is no problem you cannot solve, whom do you say that I am? You are the miracle worker. You are the mountain mover. And you are the one that finds everything in life, in my life, possible. Whom do you say that you are the lifter up of my head and carry me all through life, and whatever may be happening and whatever I may come across, you are the one that is able to hold my hand and take me to the great beyond. What you say, what you know, what you believe, what you embrace in your heart about who Christ is. Not just that you say it superficially, but down deep in your heart, whom do you say that I am? Now, Peter is going to answer, but please understand, he was before the cross, before crucifixion, before resurrection, and so the limit of what he knew that Christ is or was revealed unto him, that's what he said. Let me bring you to this side now of the cross. Whom do you say that I am? You are the one that was crucified, and I am crucified with you. Whom do you say that I am? You are the life and the resurrection, and anything that is dead, your resurrection power can wake it up. Who do you say that I am? You are the one who rose from the dead. And because of that, if you speak to the dead, that day will come, that dead will rise up. Who do you say that I am? You are the Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. And I am seated with you on the right hand of the Father. Who do you say I am? You are the one that will take a life, and every old thing will pass away, and everyone becomes a new creature in Christ. The key to your salvation, the key to your healing, the key to your deliverance is who you say Christ is. Look at verse 19 there. In verse 19, and I will give unto thee, and I will give unto thee. Now, by the way, that's Peter. The question is, when Peter died, did he take that key with him to heaven? And so now, we don't have the key. We cannot open any door. We cannot lock any door. It's given to everyone who confesses who Christ is. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever. If you have the key in your hand, the key to the car, you'll open that car and you will put in the key. That key will answer you. That key will answer. You will hear the sound. Tonight, a key in your hand. and you enter and you put it in, that mountain will move away. You bind that thing, and as you bind, that's the key. As you loose, that thing will be released and loosed. You're free tonight. Whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed. Tell me. Can I hear you? On earth, in heaven. On earth, loose it on earth, is loosed in heaven. Bind it on earth, is bound in heaven. Earth connected with heaven by the key. And the key is what you know about Christ and what you know that Christ will do. You're free already. A better life for me. A better life for me. A better life for me. A bigger life for me. A brighter life for me. The key of faith for a better, bigger, brighter life. Three things we're looking at. Number one, the mangled key in an abased, blighted life. Number two, the mandatory key to an assured, begotten life. A life that comes anew. A life that is born afresh. A life that has the newness of heaven begotten. And then you have that mandatory key in your hand. Look at that door. That door will be open tonight. Look at that mountain. That mountain is moved out tonight in Jesus' name. The mandatory key to an assured, begotten life. Number three is the master key. Master key. Master key. Do you know what they call master key? I said, do you know what they call master key? One key that can open every door in all the rooms of that hotel. That's the master key. The guest who is staying at that hotel has the key to his own room. And then another one has another key to their own room. Another one, another key. But the one who goes to inspect all the rooms to make sure that everything is all right, he holds only one key. And that one key is the master key. It comes to number 314, he opens the door. It comes to number 501, he opens the door. With that one key, there is one key that opens every door for your life. And it is called the master key. The master key to an ascending, astonishing, amazing, better life. The master key to an ascending, better life is coming to you tonight. I will have the key. I will use the key. Doors are open tonight in your life in Jesus' name. Number one, the mangled key in an abased, blighted life. God created Adam and Eve, and he gave them the key of dominion, the key of cultivation, the key of the best life anyone will ever live. The key of authority. That was the original plan, original gift, original power, original authority of Adam and Eve. That key was thrown to the ground carelessly. And powerful personality stepped on that key, mangled that key, destroyed that key, until Adam and Eve and their offspring and everyone now had a bad life, a blighted life, a life abased to the ground, because he allowed the key that God had given him to be mangled by the enemy. The mangled key in an abased, blighted life. Look at Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. It tells us there, and God said, let us make man in our image. God had the key, had the authority, had the power. And there's no power against the power of God in heaven. And now he created a man, and he said, what I am in heaven, the authority I have in heaven, the power I have in heaven, I want to give to the man on earth, so that the same authority and the same power that heaven contains, earth will have. No sin in heaven, no sin on earth. No sickness in heaven, no sickness on earth. No suffering in heaven, no suffering on earth. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion. Dominion in heaven by God, dominion on earth for man, over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Verse 27, so God created man in his own image. That's authority, that's power, that's dominion. God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female. Male and female, key, dominion, authority, power, in the hand of the man, in the hand of the woman. Let's now come to chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3, verse 8. Genesis chapter 3, verse 8. And he heard the voice of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Why? Hiding man. Why? Hiding woman. They had lost the key to Satan. Satan came and asked a question. As God said, and Eve got into discussion with Satan. At the end of the discussion, Satan said, forget God. Forget his commandment. Forget what he said. Don't touch. Don't eat. Eat it. You will become something else. And she did. And she gave husband. And husband Adam ate the forbidden fruit with her. My wife is doing it. I don't have any choice. I must do it. My wife is watching it. I don't have any choice. I must watch it. My wife is telling a lie. I have no choice. I have to cover her up. I have to tell the lie, a bigger lie, to cover the smaller lie of my wife. Adam gave in to that which the wife had done. You know, there are many people like that today. They even say they are Christians. The husband is doing wrong. We are one. If the wife is doing wrong, we're one. That's what landed the world in trouble. And so Adam and Eve, after they lost the power and the authority, at that time now God came, wanted to fellowship with them. And he said, Adam, where are you? And they were told, look at verse 9. In verse 9, the Lord called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? That saying, where are you? And then in verse 10, and he said, I heard thy voice in the garden. I was afraid. There was no fear originally. When God created Adam and Eve, they feared nothing. Nothing on earth, nothing in the sea, nothing in the forest, nothing in the day, nothing in the night. They feared no animal. They feared no personality. They feared no angel. They feared no Satan. But now, they've dropped the key. The key is mangled. And because of that, he said, because I was naked and I hid myself. Now, that's how they lost everything. What they lost, we're taking it back. I am taking it back. The authority, the power, the anointing, the key that is able to decree a thing and it is done, I take it back today. Where are you? I say, where are you? You take it back in Jesus' name. Well, eventually, you know, Adam, what have you done? Why did you do that? It's not my fault. It's the fault of my wife. My wife made me do it. There are still some pygmies like that today. The pygmies of a man. A pygmy of a personality. So short, so anemic, and so weak. Why did you do that? Begin to work with me. My wife is the authority over me. My wife made me do it. Wife, why did you do that? Be gentle with me. The serpent presented it to me. Did he put it in your mouth? No. You saw. You looked. And what you looked at interested you. And so you took it. Eventually, they were driven out. But you know something about Adam? He never confessed his own error, his own evil. And there are people like that today in Job chapter 31, reading from verse 33. Job chapter 31, verse 33. If I covered my transgressions as Adam, we'll never get the key. If I covered my transgressions like Adam. Here is a chance for you. On this day, when the Lord says, I'm coming from on high, I want to give you the key that will open every door in your life. And you're still like Adam. And you cover your transgression as Adam by hiding mine iniquity in my bosom. Acting it, hiding it, nobody will know. I will not raise up my hand. I will not stand up. But so that I can cover myself and my sin, you have the respect of people around you. They say he's a good man, but you don't have the key. The key to enter to the house, you don't have. The key to enter into your car, you don't have. What's the use of that respect and that honor when you are roaming about in the street and you will not be given the key to any house to live in? But the key to heaven, the key to the presence of God, the key to the power of God. And God only requires that you will not cover your sin like Adam. If I covered my transgression as Adam by hiding my iniquity in my bosom. Look at verse 40 there. In verse 40, then thistles grow. Let thistles grow instead of wheat, and cockle instead of barley. The words of Job are ended now. There's one word that they got from Adam. Adam with A-N-T. Join an ant to that Adam. To that Adam, we have the word adamant. 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 Since the time of Adam, all the creatures on earth, all the people on earth, they become adamant. Adamant. Look at Zechariah chapter 7, reading from verse 12. Yea, they made their hearts as an adamant stone. Many people, they know it's evil, they are adamant. They know it's wrong, they are adamant. They know smoking that thing will get to their brain, scatter their brain. They are adamant. They know that adultery, fornication will bring HIV, AIDS, will bring venereal disease. They are adamant. They know that evil will bring a result and the fruit of evil in their lives. Adamant. They know, I've been doing this and doing this and doing this. It didn't bring peace in my soul, peace in my life, peace in the church, peace in the family, peace in the community. All the same, they're adamant. It's the nature of Adam that will do that thing and say, what I will do. Then you miss the key. Then you lose the key. You don't have the key of authority and the key of power. Because like Adam, instead of saying a simple word, I am sorry. Lord, I blew it. I misused my opportunity. I am sorry. Instead of that, they remain as adamant as Adam. And so, that's a blighted life. That's a bad life. That's a crushed life. That's a life that will not match up to the calling of God and creation of God. But it happened to him. It will not happen to me. I will not allow it. This bad thing will not continue.
You're tired.
This bad life will not continue. Power, authority, dominion, I get it back. Where are you? I get it back. Where are you? I get it back. Amen. Point number two now. In point number two, the mandatory key to an assured begotten life. For new things to happen, for a new life to happen, you have to be begotten. Because the original creation gave Adam the key. He lost the key. And all the offspring, all the descendants, they lost the key. And so you find a blighted life, bad life, crushed life, corrupted life. But now we want the begotten life. And what's the key? The mandatory key to an assured begotten life. Well, if anybody can tell us at all, Christ, the Lord, the Savior, the Redeemer, the one who has come to bring us back from where we were, and it brings us to a new life. If anyone can tell us at all, Christ can tell us. And he tells us the mandatory key to an assured begotten life. Mark chapter 1, reading from verse 14. Mark 1 verse 14. Now, after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel, the good news of the kingdom of God. That's what Adam lost. The opportunity, the liberty, the privilege, the right to remain in the kingdom of God. Eden, a type, a symbol of the kingdom of God. He lost the privilege and that right. But now Christ came, the King of the kingdom, the Son of God, our Redeemer, our Savior, the one who came to reconcile us back to God. He came and now is going to show us the mandatory key to enter into the kingdom. Look at verse 15. In verse 15, and saying, the time is fulfilled. Your time is fulfilled. Your time has now come. My time has now come. From chapter 3 of Genesis, when they lost the key, they have been trying and trying. Chapter 4, Cain killed Abel. And then you come to chapter 6, God said, it's all over. For all men, for every man in his imagination has corrupted himself. The time is over. The flood came. After the flood, then you have Noah and the three sons and the three wives. Again, the imagination of the heart of every man was evil. You have the Tower of Babel. God scattered them. And then you go on and on. That in Genesis, all the brothers of Joseph sold him to slavery. Then you have Exodus, and the children of Israel were oppressed. They had not discovered the key, but now Christ came and Christ announced and he said, the time is fulfilled. My time has come. Your time has come. We're not going to live lives blighted, destroyed, defiled, corrupted by the example of Adam. Now we can have the key and we can enter into the kingdom of God. You will enter today. Amen. You'll enter today. Amen. I'm not talking about somebody, you know, is left the nightclub and is coming to the house, and daddy and mommy said, this boy, when will he learn his lesson? Every night we'll be waiting here till 2 a.m. before this boy will wake everybody up and knock the door and then say, I'm here, open for me. He does not have the key himself. The father does not trust him to give him, does not trust her to give her any key. Knocking and knocking. And then one of the boys out there, one of the girls sat there, phoned him, phoned her. What are you now? I'm pretending, saying, I'm in the house already. He's outside, he's outside. But he's telling his friend back over there, I'm inside already. There are many people, they do not have the key to enter, and they have not entered. Their lives are oppressed. All the elements of weather beating on them, destroying them, and they are suffering. And instead of having the key to enter, they're telling people that call them, where are you? Oh, I'm in the house. There's no way they can tell that I'm not in the house, so I'm going to tell them I'm in the house. But I want suffering. And you can tell the Lord the right thing today. I've been telling people I'm a Christian. I've been telling people I'm a believer. I've been telling people I am in the kingdom. But I know for a fact that I'm not inside. And today, you're coming. And the Lord will give you the key into the kingdom. And when you have that key, instead of, you know, I have this need, am I going to get you? Bring the key out, you open the door, abundance will come for you in Jesus' name. The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Repent ye, that means turn around. You have been walking to the nightclub every night. Turn around and turn your back to the nightclub. You've been walking to the house of the gang that will say, let's do it, let's do it, let's do it. Now turn around, turn your back to those gang members, because you are not in fellowship again. That's repentance. You've been going drinking and drinking until you are in a stupor, and you don't know what you are doing, where you've been going, what you have been in. Turn around, turn your back to that drinking, and make sure that you tell the Lord wholeheartedly, Lord, I repent. You have been in fornication and adultery. And every time, you know what you do to stir up yourself to want to go and do evil. Stop. Turn around. Turn your back on all those things. Repent ye. And as you do that, believe the gospel. What's gospel? The gospel is good news. Glad tidings. That Christ died for you, and Christ bore your punishment. And now that the key you have lost, no authority in your life, no confidence in your life, no courage in your life, and no ability to stand, no backbone in your life, because you lost the key, you now believe the good news. The key will come back to you. Yeah. Salvation will come. Yeah. Healing will come. Yeah. Deliverance will come. Yeah. All those secret sins that you've been committing, you pack them aside. You say bye-bye forever. Repent ye and believe the gospel. And you know, as you do that tonight, a new strength will come. A new energy will come. A new boldness will come in your life in Jesus' name. And when those partners in evil, partners in transgression, partners in immorality. When they come, you know, in the past, you say you make resolution, God, I will not, God, I will not. And when those partners in sin, partners in destruction, when they come, resolution will flee away. You don't have the power to say no. But now, when Christ comes in your heart, and those partners come, as they are coming, you stand waiting for them. I'm talking to somebody there. And then as they come, you see, before you talk, let me tell you something. I repented of my sin, and now my life is new. My life is fresh. And now the Lord is living here with me. And the things I used to do, I find I don't have any interest in them anymore. I am saved. That partner will step back a little. Let me hear an amen over there. And while that partner is telling himself, you know, stepping back, and then also, I'm telling you, if you don't repent, you won't know what will happen to you. I'm calling upon you. I've repented. I've given my life to Christ. Now a new life has come, and I want you to, you're now bold to preach to them. Things will change. I said things will change. All that, you know, kind of life inside you, the life of a bat, not really part here, not really part there, the life of a chameleon, not here, not there, and the life of a timid, fearful person, that all the people around you are controlling your life to destroy you. All that control will stop in your life in Jesus' name. Repent ye and believe the gospel. That's what you will do tonight. I say that's what you will do tonight. I'm telling you, the key will come back to your life. The key will come back to my life. Look at number three now, the master key. The master key to an ascending, ascending, ascending better life. I praise God for you. I said I'm praising God for you. From today, as you get this master key, your life will be astonishing. Your life will be a wonder. Your life will become better, brighter, bigger. It will be like, is it me? Something will touch your brain for good. Something will touch your heart for good. Something will touch your life for good. Better life. Brighter life. Bigger life. The Lord will grant unto you in Jesus' name. Matthew chapter 18, verse 18. Matthew chapter 18, verse 18. Verily I say unto you, whatsoever ye shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. You lost your amen there. And whatsoever ye shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Whatsoever, whatsoever, whatsoever. There's no limit when you have the master key. Once you repent and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, Christ will give the same key he had when he was on earth. He will give that key unto you. You know, when Christ was on earth, he said, everything I have done in the name of my Father. And once he looks up and he says, Father, I know you have heard me because you always hear me. And he uses the name of the Father. That thing will be done. Now he turns around. He says, you repent, you believe, I give you the master key of my name. Look at it, John chapter 14, verse 13. John 14, 13. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, remember, whatsoever you bind on earth, whatsoever you loose on earth, whatsoever. Now it says, whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, if you have turned away from Satan, you have turned away from sin, you have turned away from all the bad things in society, and you have turned unto the Lord, and he becomes your Savior, and he has given you now the master key of his name, nothing will be impossible in your life. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do. That will I do. That will I do. Now, when you have the key and you put it inside the keyhole and you turn it, what will happen? What will happen? The door will open. Then you will say, I opened the door. I said, no. The key opened the door. Am I right? You are young, you have the key, the right key. You are a man, you have the key, the right key. You're a woman, you have the key, the right key. You are just coming in today into the kingdom. And you have the key, the master key, and you put it in. What will happen to that door? The door will open. You say, I open the door. No, the key, the name, open the door. I praise God for you. Look up at me here, smile at me. I can't see your teeth. Smile. Smile at me. Congrats. You have the key tonight. And the key will open the door. Whatsoever ye shall ask the Father in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Tonight is your night. I said, tonight is your night. Remember the mandatory key, repent and believe. And then the master key will be put in your hand. And whatsoever demand, whatsoever request you have, as you open your mouth, it will be done. I said, it will be done. You do what is said, and he will do what you are saying. Are you ready? I said, are you ready? No pretense tonight. No acting as if tonight. No adamant attitude tonight. No covering up tonight. No hiding anywhere, anything tonight. Adam, where are you? You're telling. Why? You're not given an excuse. You say, Lord, I allow the key to be dropped, and the key is mangled. I'm sorry. I turn my back on my sin, and I turn my face to the Savior. The Lord will forgive you. The Lord will set you free. And now the key to live in newness of life. The Lord will give you the key. And now when the tempter, the temptress, the whatever, when they come, the power of God will be in your heart. You will say no. And when you say no to the devil, he will flee away from you in Jesus' name. The Lord is ready for you. Heaven is ready for you. Are you ready for God? I said, are you ready for God? The key will come in your life right now. You'll enter into the kingdom of God. Heads bowed and eyes closed. Heads bowed and eyes closed. Tonight, with all sincerity, tonight, with all honesty, you say, Lord, I know to have the key now to repent, to turn my back on my past corrupted life, defiled life, sinful life. I turn my back to the sins of my life. I now come face to face with the Savior. Lord, I repent. Lord, I believe. Wherever you are, you raise up your hand. In all sincerity, in all honesty, Lord, here I come. Here I come. All that defilement, I turn away. All that sinfulness, I turn away. All that evil, I turn away. All that deception, I turn away. All that covering up, I turn away. And this is the only way, the key of authority and power of a new life can come to you. Raise up that hand. If you're raising up your hand, honest, truthful, transparent, you really say, I hand over my life to the Lord. Lord, forgive me. Lord, change my life. I believe that Christ died for me on a cross of Calvary. Raise up that hand. If you're raising up your hand, you'll stand up. In the presence of the Lord, with all honesty, you stand up. Say, Lord, I realize tonight, no more covering up. No more pretense. No more hiding. No more excuse making. Stand up wherever you are. With your hand raised. As you're standing up, tell the Lord sincerely, honestly, wholeheartedly, I turn away from my sin. I turn to my Savior. I believe that Christ died for me on the cross of Calvary. I receive your forgiveness. I receive your freedom. I am saved. I am changed. If any man be in Christ, is a new creature. Behold, old things have passed away, and all things have become new. Keep on standing. Let me pray with you. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for reconciling us to yourself through Christ, redeeming our lives, and bringing salvation to every soul accepting. I pray, Lord, the assurance of salvation bring to every life tonight. In Jesus' name. new life, a new confidence, assurance in the Lord, total forgiveness, complete freedom. Grant to everyone right now in Jesus' name. Lord, give us back what Adam lost, the authority, the dominion, the assurance he lost. Give your children back in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, because I know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. It is done. It is done. Your sins are forgiven. Your life is now made anew. We ask our pastor, the state overseer for your state, to take over now and lead us in this time of counseling.